Chapter 67 to 72. Right now, I'm standing on the ground. In front of me is the King of Dwargon, Gazel Dwargo himself in all his majesty. Behind him are all his Pegasus knights. Rimuru, so, how are we going to do this? Whoever makes the first strike wins? Gazel, fine by me. But are you sure about this? Asking me, the master of the sword, for a spar. Gazel asks me while readying his weapon. As you might have guessed, Gazel and I are about to have a little spar. Rimuru, ahaha. You can't fool me, you would have brought it up regardless. I just skipped straight to the subject. Gazel just smiles without answering. I'm right after all. I know from reading the novel and watching the anime. Gazel believes someone's true self will reveal itself in a clash of swords. Since I'm powerful enough to take down an orc lord, I can be a threat to Dwargon. Gazel wants to know if I'm an enemy or someone that can be reasoned with, hence the spar. I quickly brought up the subject of a spar, knowing Gazel would accept, and now we're here on the ground preparing ourselves. Gazel unsheathes his sword while I took out Yamato from my gluttony stomach and moved Shizu's anti-magic mask to the side of my head. It might seem a bit overkill for just a spar, but I don't plan on unsheathing Yamato from its scabbard. Instead, I tie the seijo of the scabbard around the guard of the blade, ensuring it doesn't just fly off and casually murder someone. Gazel, a good sword. Very much cared for. Gazel looks at my sword and mutters under his breath. Anyway, we quickly finish our preparations and Gazel asks me a question that brought to my attention a glaring issue. Gazel, so? Who should officiate this spar? That's right. We don't have a fucking referee. Of course, being the genius that I am, I already have a solution. I could ask Ranga to do so, or Gazel could just nominate one of his men, but having a neutral third party would be best. Furthermore, the person I have in mind could also get rid of the little prejudice Gazel and his men have against me. Also, so, I speak out loud into the wind. Rimuru, could you help us out a little, trainee? At first, everyone watching me was confused. Did I suddenly go crazy? What kind of mushrooms am I eating? But then a breeze of wind brushes past us, and after some visual effects with leaves, vines and branches, a certain dryad reveals herself. Trainee, gladly, Sir Rimuru. My name is Trainee, a dryad and caretaker of the forest. At the request of Sir Rimuru, I shall officiate this spar. As expected of Trainee, she quickly noticed my intentions and acted like she's only doing this because I asked her to. Well, I know she's also having her own little fun. But in the end, this achieves the goal I was aiming for. A dryad. Why is one appearing now? Does the dryad have some connection to that slime? Murmurings break out in the knights behind Gazel. Gazel himself is also surprised at this turn of events, looking at me and Trainee. Gazel, silence. This slim Rimuru and I are speaking. I will evaluate him myself and I would appreciate it if you would not create a racket. This is the first time Gazel called me by my name. As expected, showing my connections to a dryad made him realize that I have real backing aside from my strength. Rimuru, then let's get started, shall we? Gazel, indeed. We both raise our weapons and ready our stances. Trainee, ready? Begin. Rimuru, surprise meat bun attack. I take out a meat bun and throw it at Gazel. It hits him square in the chest, denting his armor and sending him flying back with his limbs flailing helplessly. Trainee, what? Kakioin. He was suddenly blown away. Impossible. I see Trainee enjoys the holy texts I gave her. Well, that meat bun was mostly harmless, only denting Gazel's armor and sending him flying away with the knockback enchantment I added on it. He took no damage, so he quickly corrected his position in the air and landed back on his feet, dragging lines in the dirt as the laws of inertia work their magic. However, within that time, I quickly ran up to him and by the time he noticed, I'm already in front of him swinging my wooden sword down at his head. He quickly lifts his sword above his head, parrying it and swinging his sword at me from the side. I lean back as it flies over my chest and I flip back using my hand as a spring. This time Gazel takes the initiative. Without any pause, he jumps forward swinging his sword at me from my left, to which I block. All this happened in just a couple of seconds. Our attacks are mere blurs to the knights watching, each strike creating a small shockwave. We continue this stalemate for a minute or so with no one gaining the upper hand. One person attacks while the other either dodges, parries, or outright blocks it. Neither of us ever landed a solid hit. Of course, I'm restraining myself. My physical strength on par with a true dragon has been reduced to Gazel's level with Raphael's help, and I'm not using any other skill in this fight except Universal Perception to help me track his movements. I'm fighting Gazel with my raw skill right now. I know I said flex my muscles, but it's not like I can just beat this guy into the ground. There will be a whole lot of problems that will occur if I absolutely floor the guy, after all. And I don't want to deal with them. Well, Gazel is also going easy on me. He has trained in the sword for centuries, my meager month or so of training can't compare, even with my comprehension rune. Although if this was a serious fight with none of us holding back, I would win. I feel a little smug knowing that. Of course, fate feels like fucking me over at this point, and I just so happen to not notice a little rock behind me, which I just so happen to trip over, while Gazel just so happened to be making an attack, which I just so happen to be able to block if I didn't trip. Man, fuck my life. And so, I find myself on the floor with Gazel's sword pointed at my neck. Trainee King Gazel wins. Sigh. Oh well, what's done is done. I look next to my foot to see that very same rock that I tripped over. I turn it into a small Boku no Pico poster. I'm not salty. Gazel, that was a good fight. Gazel sheaths his sword and extends his hand to me, to which I grab and he pulls me up. Rumor of same here, I learned a lot. Although I would have won. Gazel, gahaha. Sure, keep dreaming. Rimuru what? I'm serious. Immediately after we began talking like good friends with smiles on our faces. The knights watching from the side are still confused as Gazel and I kept talking about the spar we just had and our thoughts. Eventually, I was deemed as a good slime by Gazel and I invited them all over to my town. Suddenly, he looks down and notices something. Gazel, hmm? What's this? Arg! My eyes! Oops. It seems he found the poster. He won, but at what cost? I'm walking through the forest talking with Gazel more about the spar we just had. Following behind us are approximately 500 Pegasus Knights. Of course, we're not walking on foot, but rather we're all on our separate mounts, casually moving through the forest. I mean, you can't expect a king to walk back to town on foot, can you? Especially since it's quite a distance away. And so everyone is riding their respective Pegasus while I am on Ranga. No, I didn't forget about him during the spar, really. And although I say casually moving through the forest, it's more like Ranga trying to assert his dominance against the prideful Pegasi by always moving a bit faster, while the Pegasus themselves are also trying to show this crass wolf his place, which eventually ended up in a full-blown race between the white wolf and the 500 white Pegasi. Not that anyone is saying anything. Specifically, it's because Gazel and I are extremely casual about this, while the knights themselves are holding on for dear life. Meanwhile, the knights themselves were thinking. Knights, why are our Pegasi moving so much faster than their time during training? What the hell is even going on? Gazel, still, I am surprised you managed to block my haze of rumbling heavens. Quite impressive. What the fuck is with that Chiyuni name? Rimuru, hmm? Aw, that move. True, I did have some trouble with it. I'm not exactly lying. Haze of Rumbling Heavens was a move Gazel used that caused him to instantly appear in front of me, striking at me from below before immediately switching to an overhead strike with extreme speed, almost as if there are two strikes at once. Of course, with Universal Perception, I could deal with it. Not only that. Rimuru, well, it's a move my teacher used on me quite often. Specifically, it's the move Hakuru would use whenever he wants to beat my ass into the ground. I remember Gazel also learning the sword under Hakuru a couple of hundred years ago, so I made sure to watch out for that move. Gazel, hmm? Your teacher. It wouldn't happen to be Dash. Rimuru, the sword ogre? Yeah. Although I named him and he goes by Hakuru now. Gazel, because incredibly surprised at that. Gazel, then that must mean you are my brother under the same teacher. Gazel was really happy learning that I was under Hakuru's tutelage. Since Hakuru wasn't named at the time, he simply went by the title of Sword Ogre. And since Gazel doesn't know his new name, I called him by his old title. Gazel, remember to call me Elder Brother, got it? Gahaha. He's getting quite the kick out of it. I just smile as my lips twitch. Just you wait. I'll show you who's the Elder Brother. Just give me a few decades. Eventually, we reach town and Ranga and the Pegasi finish their race, with the latter learning how foolish it is to challenge a Spatium Star Wolf to a race. Ranga ended up having this smug smile for the rest of the day, while his steps had flair and purpose. Waiting for us at the edge of town are Benimaru, Shion, Hakuru, Soai, Rigard, Kaijin, Makoto and Shizu on Makoto's head. Soai quickly noticed a large force approaching town, but I notified him that everything is fine through thought communication. At my request, he gathered everyone aside from Shina and Kurobe as they're busy with Shina making new clothes and Kurobe making new weapons. Makoto looks at Ranga's smug attitude and looks at me with a confused face and a raised eyebrow. Damn, she's so cute. Wait, not now. I just nod to her, gesturing that I'll explain everything. Geza looks at the waiting group before quickly noticing Hakuru and Kaijin, causing him to unmount his Pegasus and walk up to them. Kaijin runs forward and kneels respectfully. Kaijin, it's a pleasure to see you again. Geisel nods at Kaijin and answers with an ever-so-faint smile. Geisel, it's been a long time, Kaijin. What do you say about serving under me again? Rimuru, oi, Geisel. Don't go poaching my subordinates like that. I walk up from behind Geisel with a teasing smile on my face. Geisel, gahahaha. Geisel just laughs it off and turns to Hakuru. Meanwhile, Kaijin was frozen due to not keeping up with the fact that we just talked to each other like old friends. Geisel, are you the sword ogre? Hakuru, hmm? Aw, that little boy from way back when? I was wondering why you had such a familiar feeling. It turns out you grew into such a fine man. Hakuru, you sound like an old grandma praising her grandson after not seeing him for a while. Shing. Geisel and Hakuru keep talking to each other while I slowly back away with cold sweat as I catch the falling piece of cloth from the collar of my clothes. Hakuru is scary. Time continues to pass and we all eventually find ourselves in the high-class resort connected to the hot spring. The nights are off God knows where and only everyone who greeted us at the edge of town earlier today is here, including Kurobe and Shina. We all had a nice relaxing bath and now we're unwinding with food and drinks courtesy of Shina in an open-air room wearing hot spring yukatas, also courtesy of Shina. No, I didn't go in with the women. Sad face. Geisel officially explained the reason for his meeting, letting everyone know the reason for his visit while I then explained what happened after I gave everyone that gonna go for a walk, thought communication, message and teleported in front of Geisel. Makoto, Rimuru, you are an idiot. What would have happened if they were hostile? Makoto plainly stated while looking at me. I just smile warmly at her. Makoto, W what? Rimuru, nothing. I just feel happy knowing that you worry for me. That causes Makoto to immediately break out in a shade of red. Makoto, W, who's worried about you? Classic tsundere reply. I love teasing this woman. Furthermore, she looks beautiful in her hot spring yukata. Geisel just rubs his chin while looking at the two of us with a glint in his eye. After Makoto ran off as a stuttering mess with steam rising from her head after my teasing, Geisel walked up to me and whispered. Geisel, you know, I was also pretty popular with women back in the day. If you need advice. He pats my back with a knowing look while I just smile at him with twitching lips. Popular, my ass. This guy just wants to hear updates on the situation. Hot spring. Geisel and I just had our spar, and now we're all unwinding for the day at the hot spring resort. After some thinking, I decided to sneak into the female's hot spring ahead of the girls. I also placed down various runes to isolate this place to prevent any peepers. Rimuru, this is the life. I say this while sinking deeper into the steaming waters. Although I have cancel natural elements, which also makes it so I can't feel temperature, I can lower my resistances a bit so now I can feel the warmth of the water. I am currently in my gender-neutral human form. As of right now, I am alone. But not for long. Slam. Shion, hot spring. Shina, Shion. Stop running, you might fall. Makoto, Shina's right. What if you break the floor? A trio of beautiful women opens the door, separating the women's change rooms and hot spring, all covered with towels tied around their chests. Rimuru, you girls are quite loud, aren't you? I speak up with a small smile on my face. Shina, Rimuru-sama. Shion, Rimuru-sama, you're here. Shina and Shion turn their heads towards the voice to find me already neck-deep in the water. They smile as they respectfully greet me and Shion calms down as they both walk towards the water. Makoto, Rimuru! What are you doing here? Makoto half-screams as her entire face immediately turns a shade deeper before squatting down and attempting to cover as much of her exposed silky skin as she can. Rimuru, wait, oi, at this rate you'll overheat before you even set foot in the hot spring, you know? Makoto, bbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbbb Cheyenne Ramurusama is right, you know? Shina, the water feels really relaxing. Cheyenne and Shina are already in the hot spring, exposing their bodies without a hint of shame as the towels that used to cover them are discarded to the side. Ramuru, if you're that uncomfortable, here. How about now? I transformed into my female form. My chest and ass expanded while my waist shrunk slightly and my face and voice turned feminine. After a few more minutes of convincing from all three of us, Makoto finally relented and sat in the hot spring as far away from me as she can. Her face is still in a heavy shade of red and her eyes are swirling a bit from dizziness. On the other hand, Shina and Cheyenne are sitting directly next to me, just enjoying my company. In fact, they're currently leaning on me right now as my arms are resting around their shoulders. I look like a playboy, no, would it be playgirl now? But still, Cheyenne and Shina are incredibly beautiful women. Cheyenne has a bombshell body and is the most developed out of all three women. Her boobs especially are quite large as her pink nipples are currently bobbing in and out of the water. My eyes are mesmerized at them as I wonder how soft they would be to the touch. I quickly focus on the girl in my other arm, Shina. Her body is mostly clothed in loose-fitting yukatas or shrine maiden, so no one really notices, but Shina has quite a stacked body herself. Her breasts are around size C or even D. Her ass is also quite prominent. Although she isn't large in all her areas, her body is what I would call the golden ratio. Her breasts, waist, and ass complement each other better than the other two. Of course, as an ass and legs man, Makoto is still my favorite. However, Cheyenne and Shina are very close to taking her spot. While I was thinking such things, Cheyenne, Shina, Kia. My hands were unconsciously fondling their assets. It wasn't until they couldn't take it anymore and released their own respective moans from my surprisingly dexterous hands that I realized what I was doing. Their bodies trembled as my hands pinched their nipples one last time before quickly letting go and their bodies fell loosely into my arms. Did they come? Their breaths became quite rough and before I could apologize, they opened their eyes. They looked towards me and with pink and purple hearts replacing their pupils. Shina and Cheyenne spoke to me. Shina Ramurusama. Cheyenne Moore. They both grab one of my hands and place it on their breasts and immediately, I started moving my fingers. Moan. Immediately after they started breathing heavily and moaning again, not caring about keeping quiet this time. I do this for several more minutes, feeling them tremble several more times before I remove my hands from their breasts. Before they could protest, however, I immediately attack their sacred gardens beneath the water. Cheyenne Shina Rimoha. Immediately after their bodies shake and fall onto my chest. Doing this I can confirm, they don't have hair down there. It's very soft and smooth. After a few more moments, they barely regain their sense of movement and look towards me with heated eyes. Shina jumps forward and attacks my lips with her own. Without saying anything, our tongues intertwine into a messy sloppy kiss while Shina wraps her arms around my neck. My hand that was fingering her garden snake around her back and attacks her pussy again, this time from the direction of her ass. Cheyenne, however, takes a different approach. She places her hand on my stomach, slowly sliding it down before reaching my own vagina and entering it. Ramuru MMM. I moan into Shina's mouth as electricity runs up my spine and pleasure hits my brain. Heck, I don't even have a brain. Cheyenne's mouth, however, lowers and starts playing with my nipple, running her tongue around it while biting it occasionally, constantly sending waves of stimulation to my head. Oh my fucking god, this feels amazing. Do all women feel this? Holy shit, I'm actually quite jealous. At this point, my eyes have already rolled to the back of my head and I'm very sure I'm currently making an ahigo face. We continue pleasuring ourselves for nearly an hour, switching things up along the way. I even changed my age every now and again, from a loli to a mature MILF. My favorite was when I laid down under the water and Cheyenne sat on my face as I stimulated her pussy with my tongue. Meanwhile, Shina unceasingly rubbed her own pussy against mine in a scissoring position with my leg hanging over her shoulder. Shina ha. Wa. Rimuru-sama. Cheyenne Rimuru-sama. Right there. All of us never stopped moaning as our constantly violent movements made splashes and minor waves in the hot spring waters. Honestly, this is the best way to utilize the fact that I don't need to breathe. This way, we don't even need to leave the hot spring. Our juices spread out into the waters, completely saturating the water and air with our smell. Heck, I drank some accidentally, and it tasted something like honey or nectar. This is how you make fucking bathwater, Belle Delphine. We continued to pleasure ourselves in all kinds of positions. Meanwhile, a certain tea-color-haired railgun is sitting off to the side, masturbating. Third person, POV. At first, Makoto was incredibly shocked at this turn of events. She wanted to say something, but she also didn't want to stop them. In the end, she chose to hide her presence and observe. Things quickly escalated, and now Shion is sitting on Rimura's face, while Shuna is grinding her vagina against Rimura's. Both of them are moaning like mad with hearts in their eyes, all three of them concentrating on nothing but pleasuring themselves and their partner. Makoto's left hand is covering her mouth to muffle the moans she makes so as not to disturb the scene in front of her, while her right hand is furiously rubbing her sacred gardens. Drool sometimes leaks from the gaps in her fingers, but even so, her eyes never left the scene in front of her. Unknown to herself, however, is that she unconsciously shifted closer and closer to get a better view. Eventually, she found herself quite close to the entanglement of bodies. However, she only reached this point as things were coming to a close. As monstrous as Shion and Shuna were, they still had a sense of stamina. In the end, they were knocked unconscious by the pleasure and ended up getting carried outside by Rimuru, laying on the warm wooden benches off to the side with satisfied expressions and a mixture of hot spring water and all three of their sticky juices dripping out of their vaginas. Makoto realized her positioning and decided to quickly leave the hot spring out of embarrassment. But before she could grab, a hand shot out and grabbed her wrist. Before she could voice out her protest, she was dragged back into the hot spring. Immediately after, she was kissed. Deeply, at that. Her inexperienced tongue was quickly overpowered as her saliva was greedily savored by the other. Opening her eyes slightly, a beautiful feminine face with golden eyes and snow-white hair enters her eyes. Makoto grabs the other person's shoulders and forcefully separated their mouths. Makoto Rimuru dash. Rimuru, I always wanted to do this. Makoto was cut off by Rimuru and was immediately assaulted on her lips again. Their bodies pushed up against each other, Makoto's back pressing up against the interior wall of the hot spring and Rimuru pushing her into it. Both of their breasts squeezed together and their nipples rubbed each other, stimulating the both of them. Rimura's leg pressed up against Makoto's vagina and her arms wrapped around Makoto's neck. Rimuru no hair down there either, puberty is coming late? Rimuru breaks the kiss to make a small comment. Makoto glares at her while breathing heavily from trying to deal with the explosion of pleasure going off in her mind. She opens her mouth to reply, but it was quickly plugged up by Rimura's mouth. Makoto struggled at first, trying to escape the sense of pleasure crashing against her. However, after not accomplishing her wish, she slowly began to lose that desire and also began reciprocating her kiss while her arms unconsciously found their way hugging Rimura's back. After doing so for a while, they finally broke their kiss with a string of saliva connecting the two mouths and Makoto took a deep breath. Not from a lack of air, but from the amazing experience she just went through. Of course, Makoto had no time to rest as she was immediately flipped around with Rimura's body pressing up against her back. MCPOV. My breasts push into Makoto's back. I can feel Makoto's developing ass press into my hips. Makoto Rimu-a. She begins to ask what am I doing, but I quickly answer her by rubbing her clitoris with my right hand fingers while kneading her developing breasts and pinching her nipple with my left. I also started licking and kissing her neck and ears while occasionally biting it, leaving a mark. Makoto. Her body tensed, but she didn't moan. Thinking I wasn't pleasuring her enough, I increased the speed at which my fingers are moving. Still, she didn't once speak out. I once again increase my speed and her body squirms. Her legs tremble and I feel her holding her breath. It was at this moment I realized what exactly was going on. It's not that I was lacking in my technique honed by the two beautiful Kijin. Nor was it that Makoto wasn't sensitive enough. It's that Makoto's body is too sensitive. So much pleasure is assaulting her mind that even her natural responses shut down. Her body froze up and she didn't moan, not because she didn't want to, but because she couldn't. After speeding up, her body even forgot to breathe. That is how much pleasure her mind is dealing with due to her overly sexually sensitive body. You also have to take into consideration that Makoto is an Esper. Her mental capabilities are several thousand to several hundred thousand times higher than the average human. God, that's so fucking hot. Getting aroused, I stick my middle and ring fingers into Makoto's vagina and press on the roof of her pussy. Schlick. Immediately after, like a puppet with cut strings, her legs give out and her body falls. I catch her body and turn her around to look at her expression. Painted on her face is nothing but pleasure. Her eyes are rolled backwards and her mouth in a warped smile with clenched teeth, with drool leaking out. she was knocked unconscious from the pleasure. At this point, Cheyenne and Shuna woke up again and we both continued our entanglement of pleasure. Makoto woke up halfway through our second run and was also pulled into it. In the end, we continued this for hours upon hours doing nothing but pleasuring the other sexually while getting knocked out before waking up and doing it all over again, with me being the only person who stayed awake throughout the whole thing. And then I woke up. Everyone is unwinding over food and drinks in the recently constructed resort right after getting out of the hot spring. This resort was quickly built at my request by the High Orcs and High Ogres. As an aside, the High Ogres decided to join the High Orcs in construction around town, so now things are really speeding up. Anyway, I was having a drink with Gazel when he suddenly looks at me with sharp eyes. Seeing this, I put down my drink and sit up properly. We're about to have a serious talk. If before Gazel was enjoying himself as my elder brother, now he is currently looking at me as the king of Dwargan. Gazel, Rimuru. There are a couple of important things I must talk to you about. I don't say anything and just nod, signaling him to continue. I already have an idea of what he wants to talk about. This happened in the series after all. The alliance between my nation and Dwargan. Gazel, first off, the most important one. I would like a supply of these meat buns shipped to Dwargan every week. Rimuru, deal. Gazel, good. Now onto the less important subject. Rimuru, would you like to form a covenant with me? I ask you not as a fellow student of Hakuru, but as the king of my nation. You, the leader of the forest, are in an equal position with me. Rimuru, so, an alliance? Are you sure about this? It's basically saying that we're a proper fully fledged nation. I'm simply asking for formalities at this point. As expected, Gazel didn't hesitate to nod his head. We fleshed out the details of the alliance. This was done quickly due to both of us knowing what we wanted and not really having any intention to trick the other into something dubious. Benimaru, Rigard, and surprisingly Shuna also gave a few pieces of advice. In the end, the alliance turned out pretty much like how it did in the series. A non-aggression treaty, assistance whenever the other nation is endangered, a road leading from my town to Dwargan, guaranteed safety for our citizens while in the other country, and technology sharing. Of course, I added something of my own as well. Rimuru, I would also like for Dwargan to support us financially. That is my personal condition. I know the general events of the future, and so I know that my town will eventually become a center for trade throughout most of the world. However, as of right now, we have no money. And Dwargan is a rather rich nation, so. Gazel, but isn't it a bit unfair towards us? Rimuru, haha. Gazel, I said this before, but you can't fool me. I'm the one footing the bill for the road construction. It might be easy to make a road leading to Dwargan for us monsters, but I know that it would be a much harder challenge for you. Think of it like you're just paying us for the job. Gazel stares at me, but I don't shy away and stare right back at him with a small smile on my face and a completely relaxed posture. Gazel finally ended up breaking a smile of his own before chuckling. Gazel, gahahaha. Rimuru, you really are an interesting slime. Very well, I accept. However, there is a limit to how much we can supply. I hope you understand that. Rimuru, don't worry, we don't need the money right now. Later on, we just need to borrow a small amount to get us off the ground when we start dealing with humans. After that, well, it shouldn't be too straining on your coffers. I reassure Gazel while shaking hands with him, thus establishing the alliance. Gazel, by the way. What's the name of your nation? I already have a name in mind, so I open my mouth to answer. But before I could. Cheyenne, let's name it Rimuru. Let's not do that, thank you. I immediately shot Cheyenne down, so she ended up feeling pretty bummed out. I felt a little bad, so I turned into my slime form and jumped into her arms. Needless to say, she completely forgot about what just happened and enjoyed cuddling me. Now, back to the name of the nation. I've already had this name in mind for a long time. I open my mouth and speak. Rimuru, the Meat Bun Kingdom. Time rewinds a bit. Rimuru, the name of my nation will be Jugimu Jugimu Gokono Surikar Kaijari Suijo no Suijamatsu Unraimatsu Furaimatsu Kuneru Tokoro Anisimu Tokoro Yaburakoji no Burakoji Pipo 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 no Shuringan Shuringan no Girandai Girandai no Pompakopi no Pompakona no Chokumiai no Chasuk. Everyone stops talking and looks at me. Did I say something wrong? Gazel, ho? Jagimu Jagimu Gokono Surakar Kaijari Suajo no Suajomatsu Unraimatsu Furaimatsu Kuneru Tokoro Anisimu Tokoro Yaburakoji no Burakoji Pipo 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 no Shuringan Shuringan no Girandai Girandai no Pompakopi no Pompakona no Chokumiai no Chasuk, huh? A good name. It rolls of the tongue quite well. Gazel says while stroking his beard. Shina, as expected of Rimuru-sama. To come up with Jugimu Jugimu Gokono Surakar Kaijari Suajo no Suajomatsu Unraimatsu Furaimatsu Kuneru Tokoro Anisimu Tokoro Yaburakoji no Burakoji Pipo 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 no Shuringan Shuringan no Girandai Girandai no Pompakopi no Pompakona no Chokumiai no Chasuk, he really is our lord. The Nimaru indeed. Jugimu Jugimu Gokono Surakar Kaijari Suajo no Suajomatsu Unraimatsu Furaimatsu Kuneru Tokoro Anisimu Tokoro Yaburakoji no Burakoji Pipo 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 no Shuringan Shuringan no Girandai Girandai no Pompakopi no Pompakona no Chokumiai no Chasuk is quite a catching name as well. I'm sure many people will remember this name. So I just nods off to the side. He really doesn't talk, huh? Hakuru to come up with a name such as Jugimu Jugimu Gokono Surakar Kaijari Suajo no Suajomatsu Unraimatsu Furaimatsu Kuneru Tokoro Anisimu Tokoro Yamamgai no Burakoji Pipo 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 no Shuringan Shuringan no Girandai Girandai no Pompakopi no Pompakona no Chokumiai no Chasuk, the young really do surpass the old. Everyone is muttering about how such a good name it is. I knew I made the right decision. Mikoto. Eh? Mikoto is dumbfounded. She's just looking around at everyone as they get on the Jugimu Jugimu train, confused as to why everyone is accepting it. Of course, it's not like she thinks it's a bad name or anything, but... Mikoto, isn't it? I don't know, a bit long? As expected of my voice of reason. True, it is quite long. Of course, I already have a solution. Aramura, well, I'm only planning to have this one single town anyways, so we can just call it by the town name instead of the nation itself. Mikoto, oh, that's why. So? What's going to be the name of our town? I grin, mentally at least, I'm in slime form right now, and answer proudly. Rimuru Avalon. So the covenant between me and Gazel was established, and the next day, Gazel had to leave. Something about staying out of his country for too long, causing unrest within the citizens, which could lead to the collapse of the kingdom if not dealt with. Ha, boy, I sure wouldn't want to be the leader of a nation if you have to deal with shit like that. Oh, wait. Anyway, Gazel said he would visit soon. And I know he said that, and I was kind of expecting this, but... Rimuru. Gazel. Rimuru. You know, when you said would visit soon, I didn't think that you would come back only 2 days later. Gazel, gahaha. Yes, it's been 2 days since Gazel left. I mean, I was expecting this, but... Why is this man here so quickly? Go home. Rest. In fact, did you even make it back to Dworkin? The Pegasus are fast, but it took Ranga and his pack a few days to make it from here to Dworkin as a one-way trip. Granted, they're faster now than they were then, but how fucking fast are those Pegasus? Did Gabel give them some of that weed to dope them or something? I need answers. And something tells me Gazel wouldn't tell me anything. Rimuru asterisk I asterisk so? What are you doing here? Gazel, well, I am here to give you a gift. He signals to one of his guards standing behind him. Said guard then takes a rather large object covered in a cloth from the back of his horse and threw it down in front of me. There's obviously a body inside it. I look towards Gazel. Rimuru, so you want me to help you with a murder? Gazel just gestures to the covered body again. The cloth becomes loose and reveals the body's identity. Dio Kono Dioda. Say Wayot. Beep. We are experiencing technical difficulties. The cloth becomes loose and reveals the body's identity. Kaijin Vesta. Kaijin, who was standing silently beside me not saying a word to interrupt his previous and current king, unintentionally reveals the identity of the man in the cloth to anyone who forgot about this minor character. But yeah, this guy is Vesta. The man who got me kicked out of Dworkin the last time I went there. To be honest, I kind of forgot about him, so it's not like I'm holding a grudge or anything. Of course, I want to show that I'm ruthless to any who disrespect me. Therefore, I will take up my mantle as the Nutcracker once again and deliver divine punishment. Anyway, Vesta is wrapped up like a burrito and unconscious, while Gazel continues to explain the situation. Gazel, so because it was Vesta who provoked you first which led to you getting kicked out of Dworkin, and he lied about it in court, I couldn't keep him working under me any longer. However, he is quite talented and hardworking, so it would be a waste to have him rot in the corner. Therefore, I'm giving him to you. Yep, exactly like in canon. Gazel, Vesta. Gazel turns to Vesta, who is lying on the floor unconscious. Vesta, yes? Holy shit, when did he wake up? This man is sitting upright on the floor, paying attention to whatever Gazel says next. Gazel, you will now work under Rimuru. Serve him as you would me. Vesta gets on his knees and bows. Vesta, it shall be done, my lord. Vesta begins crying like a weak ass bitch, cough. Vesta was crying because this is like a second chance to a man who thought he lost everything. Vesta turns to me and Kaijin before bowing even deeper, nearing a kowtow. Vesta, Sir Kaijin, Sir Rimuru, I truly apologize for my actions. I beg of you to find it in yourselves to forgive me. Sir Rimuru, I promise to work hard and serve you to my utmost abilities. So, please. My guy, I'm going to accept you no matter what, you don't need to beg me. I mean, who am I going to dump all my work on if you're not here? This man needs to research all the stuff I make and learn to create them without me so I don't have to do it myself. Rimuru, relax, you're hired. But I do need you to do something for me first. Vesta, really? I'll do anything. Just say the word. Rimuru, great. Stand up and spread your legs for me. Gabble, who was walking by at this point in time, hears our conversation and looks towards us from a distance. Or more specifically, he looks towards Vesta. His eyes fill with pity before he shakes his head and closes his eyes. He claps his hands together in front of him as he begins to pray to the meat bun god for this poor soul and what's about to happen. Crack. That day, people heard the return of the dying banshee. One full potion and memory wiping rune talisman later, Vesta became an official subordinate of mine. He immediately got to work on researching things. I mainly had him work with Gabble in developing the full potions manually. Gabble and his Dragonaut team would work on growing and harvesting the Hippocute herbs, while Vesta would work on processing it into a full potion. I also had Vesta work on a few other minor things too. Specifically, I had him also work with Kaijin in developing other things that would help make life easier. Magical items, to be exact. Things like showerheads, lights, toilets, and other modern-inspired stuff. I don't want my people shitting in holes in the ground, regardless if they're regularly cleaned. I mean, what if a Shinji Mato crawls out of one of them? Anyway, I'm currently walking over to the experiment site. When I arrive, I see Makoto also training herself. She's dressed in her favorite slightly oversized beige duffel jacket, but this time she's wearing a red skirt that ends above her knees. Currently, she's trying to create electrical tendrils and have them extend as far as possible without breaking. Once she makes them reach 10 meters away from her while holding them for 5 seconds, she adds another electricity tendril. It's a training method from the book I gave her. This is meant to improve her control and efficiency. I don't say anything and just watch while leaning against a tree. She's standing there with eyes closed and her right arm outstretched, unmoving. However, all around her, arcs of electricity surround her. Each arc is slow-moving, different from electricity and lightning's nature of speed. It gives the illusion that everything is moving in slow motion around her. Her hair and clothes are slightly floating and waving around from the change in magnetism around her. Dust and small rocks are also calmly following the streaks of electricity extending from all points of Makoto's body. The light of the electricity somehow only darkens the surroundings, making it seem like she's glowing instead. In my mind, I can only think of her as a goddess of lightning. Looking at her body, her face, her aura, I can't help but fall for her more. Not wanting to disturb her, I decided to turn around and leave. It's not like I'm doing something destructive, so I don't really need to be in the experimental site. What am I doing, you ask? Well, I have a few ultimate skills. I think it's about high time I get a Manus. So yeah, I want to get a Manus. I've been procrastinating on this for a while, but I think I should just get it over and done with. I'm actually unsure on which skill I should evolve into a Manus. Raphael is the first that comes to mind as it's the skill OG Rimuru evolved into a Manus, and therefore it's the most reassuring path to take. I know the results of doing so, after all. But personally, Ilya, Heaven's Feel, has been making me hesitate on this. I mean, this skill has been with me since the start and it defines me since it's the source of my main strength, my infinite magicules. Without my infinite magicules, I'm not sure I could use creation like normal any longer due to its insane magicule requirements. Well, not as freely, at least. I would have to save it only for important things. Can you imagine that? Now being able to make the buns I want at the drop of a hat? It sounds horrifying. So yeah, Ilya is also important and I couldn't choose between the two, so I just chucked that problem to future me. And would you guess it, I happen to be that future me. Fuck you past me. Cough. Regardless, yesterday I once tried to evolve Ilya into a Manus, but surprisingly it didn't work. Flashback attack. Notice. Ultimate skill, Ilya, Heaven's Feel, is lacking an ego and thus is unable to evolve into a Manus. Raphael, to the rescue once again, I quickly find out why. Digging up information from my past life, apparently, you need three things to turn an ultimate skill into a Manus. An ego slash personality, will, and self-sustenance. Normally ultimate skills all have some form of ego or will. This is because all ultimate skills can act on their own as they all have some form of meager computational abilities. Yes, all of them. Of course, Raphael is an outlier in this aspect as her individual computational abilities are way off the charts even for an ultimate skill. Now here's the kicker. Ilya doesn't have that computational ability. It doesn't have an ego. It can't act on its own. Raphael and I have no clue as to why. If I had to take a wild guess, it would be because I gained Ilya without it evolving from anything, appearing straight out as an ultimate skill. But who knows really? I tried using Rune Master and Creation to help with this by creating an ego, but those are just unique skills. They can't really do anything for an ultimate skill. I was stumped. So I decided to take a quick stroll around the quickly developing Avalon when I happened to see something that would give me inspiration for my solution. Gabuda, I don't like green dangos. Goblin Jeff, my name Jeff. Orc Jeff, my name Jeff. I met Gabuda, Goblin Jeff and Orc Jeff all sitting on a bench to the side snacking on dango. Dangos are Japanese sweet dumplings. I got curious and made some with Creation, to which Raphael immediately figured out how it was made and I just gave the recipe to an elated Shinna. Time passed and now you can see dango being sold in stores here and there. Anyway. I have no clue as to what the Jeff said, but they immediately started swapping some parts of their dango. Gabuda and Orc Jeff gave Goblin Jeff the green dangos, while Goblin Jeff and Gabuda gave Orc Jeff the pink dangos. Orc Jeff and Goblin Jeff then gave Gabuda the white dangos, and they all became happy. Seeing this, I am moment. Mind explosion, dot Jeff. Rimuru, poah. Mommy, that man is acting weird. Shush honey, don't look. The rude hobgoblins deal heavy social damage to me, and I run off into the distance with tears streaming out of my eyes like an anime girl. Roll credits. I'm joking. But I had an epiphany. If Ilya doesn't have an ego, I just need to get one from somewhere else. Like taking a working part from a broken computer and using it to replace a broken part in a working computer. As expected of Gabuda and the Jeffs, they inspired a solution for a problem that stumped even Raphael, Lord of Wisdom. Their wisdom is obviously much higher than Raphael. And speaking of Raphael, Rimuru, Raphael, do you think it's possible to transfer your ego into Ilya? Commencing simulations. Success. It is possible to do so. However, it is unknown what will happen to ultimate skill, Raphael, Lord of Wisdom, as a consequence. So you're telling me there's a chance, okay, this is good. In a way, I'm combining the two of them into one. This way I don't have to be torn between deciding which skill to evolve and I definitely don't want two Manus in my body at once. Right, I'll do it. I'll evolve Ilya into a Manus with Raphael's ego. Tomorrow. Procrastination. I'm tired. I wonder if I'll get another lap pillow from Makoto again. While Rimuru was wondering such things, he didn't see Shizu walk around the corner and steal the dango from Gabuda, Goblin Jeff and Orc Jeff while they weren't looking. Raphael, who saw everything happen through universal perception, smirks. Heh. Flashback stops. So yeah, that's what happened yesterday. I feel like I missed something, but it shouldn't be important. The plan was to use the experimental site for the evolution, but Makoto is currently training, and so I'm heading home again. I'll just do it in there. And so I find myself in the living room in my slime form. Armura right. Raphael, let's start. Understood. Beginning transfer process of ultimate skill, Raphael, Lord of Wisdom, S ego to ultimate skill, Ilya, Heaven's Feel. Success. I advise evolving the ultimate skill into a Manus very soon as both skills are quite unstable. I feel something shift within me as Raphael transfers its ego to Ilya. And it might be just me, but it sounds like it's a bit nervous. Not wanting to delay this any longer, I take a deep breath, mentally, and speak towards Ilya. Rimuru, I will name you. Ilya Sveal. Click. Something clicks into place within me, different from the time when transferring the ego. Instead of a shift, this time it feels like something is born. To evolve an ultimate skill into a Manus, you need an ego/personality, will, and self-sustenance. The ego came from Raphael, the will comes from me, and the name will serve as a core for the Manus to sustain itself separate from me. Once those three conditions are completed, a Manus will be born. I was going to name her something else, like Seal, or maybe a different original name. But I didn't. Ilya Sveal just felt right. And so, I whisper that name, calling out for a response. Rimuru Ilya Sveal. Wake up. I unknowingly tense my round streamlined slime body, getting nervous in case I fucked something up. And let's be honest, I probably did. Nothing happens, until. Yawn. Oni-chan? It was on this day my little sister Ilya was born. But I did indeed fuck something up. Raphael seems a little broken. Name, Rimuru. Race, Origin Slime. Protection, Crest of Space. Title, Highest Tier Spirit, Leader of the Monsters. Ultimate Skills, Manus Ilya Sveal, RP hashtag AEL0R $% is $OM, Belzebuth, Lord of Gluttony. Intrinsic Skills, Infinite Regeneration, Universal Shapeshift, Universal Sense, Multilayer Barrier, Enhanced Replication, Universal Thread. Unique Skills, Creation, Rune Master. Extra Skills, Lord's Ambition, Thought Communication, Control Particles, Dominate Space, Control Natural Elements. Tolerances, Cancel Pain, Resist Melee Attack, Cancel Natural Elements, Cancel Ailments, Resist Spiritual Attack, Resist Holy Attack. Equipment, Yamato, Harp. If you want to support me, check out my Patreon at https://www.patreon.com/kaioshin. I tend to polls that decide important plot stuff in my Patreon. Many thanks to my awesome patrons. Ben Phillips.
If you like this content, don't forget to like and subscribe. See you later, bye bye.